Digital Times. May we request you to kindly remain seated for this very interesting session. And I will take this opportunity to introduce the speakers and the chairperson before you. Mr. Krishnan Chatterjee, Head of Marketing, Indian Subcontinent, SAP. May I request you, sir, to kindly come onto the dais and take your seat. Mr. Krishnan Chatterjee is a core member and trusted advisor to the India Senior Executive Leadership Team, responsible for driving business results across the Indian subcontinent, comprising India, Sri Lanka, and Bangladesh markets. He is accountable for overall marketing strategy, thought leadership, awareness, demand generation, reputation and loyalty management, and end-to-end pipeline acceleration. A very warm welcome to you, sir. We're sorry about the little hodgepodge. Please bear with us. Ms. Vinita Bajoria, Executive Director, Titagarh Wagons Limited. May I request you, ma'am, to kindly come onto the dais and take your seat. Ms. Vinita Bajoria has graduated from Loreto College, MBA ICFAI, Senior Management Program IIM Calcutta, GMP and AMP at Harvard Business School USA. She has over 20 years of experience in industry and presently works as Executive Director of Indian multinational Titagarh Wagons with units in France, Italy, Rajasthan and West Bengal. In wagons, coaches, defense, shipbuilding and heavy engineering and running Sorani Tea as director with Organic Tea Garden, an exclusive boutique in Eco Tea Tourism. A very warm welcome to you, ma'am. Mr. Prasenjit, Senior Vice President and Chief Marketing Officer, Netmagic and NTTcom. May I request you, sir, to kindly come onto the dais and take your seat. Mr. Prasenjit has around 2.5 decades of corporate experience on the business side, spanning across several multinationals in India and abroad on the IT, IT technology services side, an accomplished and dynamic strategic marketing strategy, M&A and business professional. He is the evangelist of integrated strategist. Strategic marketing covering a wide spectrum of industry sectors, including financials, telecom, manufacturing, information technology, and other verticals. His relevant sales experience in different geographies helps to churn out high efficacy marketing and strategy plans across multi-locations, multi-state, and global environments. A very warm welcome to you, sir. Ms. Shivani Kapoor, Vice President and Global Head, Marketing, ITC Infotech. A very warm welcome to you, ma'am. May I request you to take a seat on the dais. Ms. Shivani Kapoor is Vice President and Global Head of Marketing at ITC Infotech. Ms. Shivani has been with ITC Infotech for over 10 years and spearheads marketing, corporate communication, inside sales, sales enablement, and the design studio. She leads a team of over 60 and sets the strategy for global marketing. As part of her portfolio, she helps position the brand across the internal and external stakeholders and ensures global marketing initiatives to meet the corporate and business objectives. A very warm welcome to you, ma'am. Our next speaker for this session is Mr. Arpan Majumdar, Senior Director and Global Head of Marketing, TCG Digital. May I request you, sir, to kindly come onto the dais and take your seat. Mr. Majumdar brings in rich experience and understanding of varied aspects of sales and marketing business functions to TCG Digital, and as part of the executive leadership team, is responsible for strategy and business development across India, Asia Pacific, and Middle East markets. He is also responsible for handling the global marketing function and working with partners and alliances across markets. A very warm welcome to you, sir. And our chairperson for this session is Mr. Jayanta Ghoshal. May I request you, sir, to kindly come onto the dais and take your seat. Mr. Jayanta Ghoshal is the editor of Ananda Bajar Patrika, Delhi. Mr. Jayanta Ghoshal is a student of political science. He had started his journalistic career as a political correspondent in 1984. And he has a special interest in the studies of changing aspects of Indian media and social media. He has got a Commonwealth Award of Journalism, and he's an accredited journalist of United Nations. He covered the General Assembly session of UN on several occasions. He has traveled abroad with all the prime ministers since the time of Rajiv Gandhiji. He has covered G20, SAARC, BIMSTEC, ASEAN, etc., and several international summits. His special interests are in Indian politics, Indian security, and foreign policy. A very warm welcome to you, sir. And I will now hand over the session to our chairperson, Mr. Jayanta Ghoshal, sir. Sir, over to you.
Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen,
I hope that you are not that tired to listen to the impact of social media after the whole day session. I believe that still you have some energy to listen our talk, because this is interesting. Since morning, we are listening digital technology, artificial intelligence, depth may be optional in your life, all these things. But now, the subject is the impact of social media in digital times. The impact of social media, what it is? Social media, so it is related to our society. The impact of the social media to the digital times everywhere, from politics to kitchen. And what is the impact? Good, bad, what it is? Today, my role is not as speaker. I am the anchor. I want to ignite the cerebral cortex of these speakers. You know, they have wisdom. They can tell you that actually the social media is good or bad. When computers came, a lot of agitation was there. We thought that computer will create joblessness in our society. Now it is accepted fact that without computer, we cannot live. So it's a law of nature. Social media is also law of nature. We have to accept it. But yes, there is a but. And that but, we want to raise that issue, that the negative aspects also. So now, I think I should stop here and I should start the dialogue. And I will take some questions also from the audience if the time permits. It's a short duration discussion. So I hope that nobody will leave this hall and you will enjoy our conversation. First, I will tell Vinita. Yeah, Vinita, if you can start your, take on this subject.
Yeah. Good evening, everybody. So we can all agree that social media has taken over our lives, and social networking has become a way of life with us. And across the, especially because of the growth of mobile telephones, so all of us have become very digitally native now. And also a sharing of information on social media is actually people do it to generate a lot of likes and to share their opinion, and also, you know, to talk about the brands and causes that they believe in. So it is shaping our lives, it's shaping politics, society, and it's impacting all these areas in several ways. Especially in politics, people say that almost 62% of the people get their news from social media, with 18% doing so very often. So before the dawn of social media, the government along with the traditional media used to be the gatekeepers of information in the society. But now with the rise of WikiLeaks, etc., now this is, and with the rise of digitally native actors, now this is no longer true. And especially with, you know, WikiLeaks and the rise of social media savvy terrorist organizations like ISIS, the shift of power calls for a complete rethink of the concept of governance. Now, on society also, almost a quarter of the world population is now on Facebook. So every person has a point of view, and he also sees that he's not alone. And especially when people find each other through social media, share opinions, get a stream of followers, they are actually shaping the way the society thinks. Now, what the social media is doing is it's killing activism and replacing it with what we call slacktivism. So social media is, of course, bringing about a lot of awareness on social issues, but now it is only, now there is a debate whether these likes actually translate into real action. Because these likes, you know, more often than not, they are just, they are not, they're just there to give your opinion. And like earlier, people used to, you know, actively contribute to making change in the society. Now that's being replaced. Now also, this has led to a lot of, you know, fall in the credibility of social media. Now, studies have shown that only 37% of the people believe in the news that is there on social media, as opposed to almost double that of in traditional media. So that is something we need to think about. Also, there is a huge, sense of, businesses, non-commerce. Now, people are trying to promote their businesses through social media. But this also has a lot of negative consequence, because brands which do not actively seek to get likes, as we say, they they are losing credibility. So there also, there is a huge negative impact. So all in all, I can say that while we do embrace, the digital age and social media, we have to be very careful about how to filter the information, about what are the issues where we have to take an active stand rather than just a passive stand, and also not try to ape people on what they, which evokes a sense of discontent when you see people doing very well, etc. So these are the things you need to be careful about while being, of course, media savvy, social media savvy. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Vinita. Now I will go to Krishnan. I'm a journalist. Don't blame me. Little cynicism I have. What Vinita is saying, I have a question to you. That, today we call it a post-truth era. It's Oxford Dictionary's latest contribution in 2016. And the post-truth means that if it is not correct, untruth, but if you can sell it through social media, it can be truth. In the Trump era, it has become very relevant. Don't you think, I'm taking the clue from Vinita, don't you think this is a very acute negative aspect what we have to face in today's social media era?
So firstly, I must say, I don't buy this post-truth nonsense at all. And I know I've hurt you deeply. But let me start with a little story, which is very personal. So I've been a musician for the last 25 years. I have my own band. I write my own music. We just launched our album 2 months back. And my daughter, currently, my elder daughter is just turned 15. Last year, she came to me and she said, can you teach me the guitar? And I don't have time. I've got a job. I've got my band. So I told her, why don't you go away and learn from YouTube? So this year on her birthday, I gave her a very expensive ukulele, because now she plays the guitar better than me. She plays the ukulele and she plays the piano. So social media has this incredibly empowering ability for all of our society. Uber is a great example to me. It created almost 400,000 jobs because of a piece of social technology. I think the question I'd like to ask is, how should we look at social media? What role does it play in our lives? It has certainly a lot of value to offer. If all we do with social media is mindlessly consume it, then clearly there may be some good, there may be some bad, but it's the same as any other form of media. Social media has an ability to do much more than that for us. We can learn from it, and we can also get other people to learn from it. So, I would always look at social media from the context of creation. If we are participating on that media to create original thinking and to learn from original thought, it has enormous power and potential to unlock value in our society. So that's one point. Second point I've seen from a business context, and again, the post-truth analogy you drove, actually, the power of this transparency is, if you believe in the so-called wisdom of crowds, which I actually do, when I read a great review on Zomato and I go to a restaurant, usually it's good. If I see a very low score for an Uber driver, I wouldn't pick that guy. End of the day, statistically, things sort themselves out. The power of the transparency means that a lot of very powerful people have lost control of the narrative. This is true for companies, for politicians, for individuals. And we have lost control over the narrative because everybody else controls it. The world controls it and shows us a mirror. That's how you saw the recent airline incidents and so many other things, right? These are things we come to know today because the power of the narrative has shifted away from the powerful to the voice of the crowd and the masses. So I think the ability to bring this kind of transparency to society, the ability for each of us to be creative in our own right and to learn whatever we wish to learn at our pace are some incredible benefits that social media is bringing to us. As long as we use it with that perspective, it'll do very good. If you don't want to use it from the perspective, there can be negative consequences, and that is true for any piece of technology. Or, you know, I can use a brick to build my house or to hurt you, Jayantul.
No, no. Thank you very much, Krishnan. Actually, I am not hurt. Rather, I have a supplementary question to you. Just very quick answer I need. That, you know, this you are saying that it's information is power regarding the recent incident of the airlines issue. But sometimes information is very selective also in social media. It's not that democratic. So there is a problem. I mean, as a journalist, sometimes we also think whether we should accept it or not from social media. Because, you know, we have to cross-check. Because sometimes it is not truth. It's a rumor. Sometimes it is creating riots also. I took interview of the Facebook chairperson of the Southeast Asia. There is no legal action we cannot take. And only there is an IT Act. You can send a notice. But actually, they are saying that it's a wall. So you can write, you can anything. And if there is another disagreement, that person or that group, they can also send it. So it's a free wall. But is it? Don't you think that there is a selective information can harm the society also?
But are you saying that journalists are not selective about information?
No. Actually, journalists are maybe information. We are selective, but we always cross-check whether that information is correct or not.
Are you sure?
We should be.
Are you speaking on behalf of the millions of journalists across the
planet? No. There is a good journalist, bad journalist, like good Taliban, bad Taliban. But actually, you know, the good police officer, bad police officer, good doctor, bad doctor. Today's discussion is not, I think.
No. So all I'm saying.
But actually, you know, this is the reality that and not only WhatsApp and Facebook, television is also part of social media.
So all I'm
lot of serials are and this Blue Whale, this game is part of social media.
Fair enough.
You cannot ignore these social cars.
I'm not ignoring it. I'm just saying whoever is in a position of controlling information has historically been selective. I think our best chance of getting the right information is through the wisdom of crowds. That is not flawless. There is no flawless model. None of us are perfect, and we will never have a perfect world. But I think the more and more people get onto the job of communicating about situations that they are personally experiencing,
right.
The higher is the probability that we will get somewhere closer to the truth, which is why I disagree with post-truth.
Yeah.
Because I think post-truth used to happen when few people controlled all the information that we had in our possession.
Yeah.
That's
Thank
just
you.
My point.
Thank you, Krishnan. Actually, you have neutralized my cynicism a little bit. I'm very happy. But I want to go to Prasenjit now, because Prasenjit is a very optimist person on this. I want to know that what you think, it is not necessarily evil. It is a positive thing, what the future of our society. What is your take on this?
Thanks, Neto. And social media is here to stay. Okay. As far as business is concerned, it has played a very critical role, both from social media marketing point of view, from social selling point of view, and there are stats that goes on to prove how effective social media in terms of buying decision, okay? Be it in terms of getting influenced by peers, be it in terms of getting research online, etc. Huge stats, and those are numbering about 85-90%. So business has got really benefited by social media. It has given you the reach, it has given the brand awareness, made it more sticky, and has reached out to segments where it was not possible before. So as an enabler to business, it has a massive impact. But there are some cons to it, okay? One of the things is, no matter how important or how number one you are in the charter or the board, if you are not accountable to customer satisfaction, you will have a bad day. So there are airlines that have got impacted by it. There are other companies that got impacted. This was not prevalent 15, 20 years before because there was no, as Krishnan said, there's no messaging that was possible at that point of time. In today's time, if you err in terms of customer service, you will be brought down to your knees. And that is something that every big corporation, be it India or be it worldwide, has to take account for, okay? Number two, there are certain segments that also one need to be very worried about. For example, I'm sure most of you know there's something called Glassdoor, okay? There are sites where employees, if they're unhappy with something or the other, can go on and rant about your unhappiness. Now this has it's like a wildfire. If you don't control it, if there's no one checking into it, it just spreads across. And by the time you realize what has happened, the fire will engulf you. So there has to be checks and balances. There have to be people who are like sentinels who have to see what the company's brand image is there. What are the wrongs that has been done? How you are being perceived in the market? And this is very, very important because we were discussing earlier, Jantu, that perception is something that is very key. If the perception of a company changes, okay, irrespective of whether it really happened or not, you get a beating. Okay, same thing happened with the airlines. Okay, whether the incident was true or false, doesn't matter. Within 2 days, the market share of the company dropped down. Okay, so that's what we are talking about in the social media. So in effect, I think it's an enabler. It really helps in the business, but obviously there are some checks and balances that need to be affected.
Thank you. Thank you, Prasenjit. Actually, some ray of hope. And Shivani, now I want to know that what is to be done? I mean, we should take a balanced view now then. You can take this.
So I'll just take a step back, okay, and look at the statistics of what we are talking about. Because the impact of social media and digital times is huge. Now, if we look at the number of people in the world, there are about 7.8 billion people in the world, out of which, if you look at this universe, there are about 3.8 billion people who have access to the internet. And if I look at this universe a little larger, 2.8 billion of these people have access and are active on social media. And 1.9 billion are active on mobile social media. So this is the universe we are talking about, and we cannot ignore it. Also, I think you and me, any of us, have at least 4 to 5 social media accounts and spend more than an hour daily on social media. Just a show of hands, how many of us are on Facebook? How many of us are on LinkedIn? How many of us are on Twitter? How many of us are tweeting this, this panel discussion? So the fact is, social media today has taken over the world. Digital revolution has amplified and completely accelerated the reach that no company can avoid and no individual can avoid being a part of it. And I think this is where I'd also like to say, you know, in ITC Infotech, we call this digitaligence at work. I'm just bringing in something where we came up with this concept saying that if disruption is the new normal and digital is the new protagonist, and intelligence is what drives innovation, we call it digitaligence at work. And I think digital is there in every phase of life. You cannot ignore it. In fact, you were talking about the pros and cons. Yes, social media is a double-edged sword. There are pros, there are cons. When we look at a campaign, we look at first is advocating. You want to talk about your brand. You communicate. Which are the channels you're communicating on? Then you're engaging with your customers. Now, here is where I believe is most important. Well-curated content. What do we want to talk about? And that is extremely important because if you're talking the right content, then you do not have this problem. Social listening. I think all the companies, and I think many of you do social listening. And I think, you know, reading a McKinsey report, and they were talking about your social influencer. 92% of your social influencers actually trust a social post, a blog, or an online post more than an advertisement or your traditional celebrity route. So, you know, yes, we cannot ignore it. This is the social media we have to be cognizant about. And just one more thing I'd like to say is that we do social listening, and post-social listening, we try to see how we can, do a corrective action. And most companies, and I think individuals, all do try to find out what their customers, employees, etc., are talking on the media, and also what they're talking about their competition. And today, you know, while we are talking about digital revolution, we can't afford to forget digital technologies, which is evolving at a very rapid state. So you have data-driven, you were talking about data. We have data-driven tools today. People are using AI to evaluate and analyze and then take corrective actions. And in fact, of course, this is also influencing decision-making. So the whole world of digital has changed today. And it is a double-edged sword, but I think, companies and individuals have to be an active part of it. Well-curated content, the right type of content is the key to this.
Thank you. Yeah.
So Philip Kotler had made this quote, which says the sales department is not the entire company, but the entire company should be the sales department. Okay. Now this is more amplified in social media. What happens is, if all the employees of the company who have a standing in social media, they have their followers and everything across, they become the first point of contact. So they have their own followers, etc., and out of which your suspects and prospects will crop up. So they become the virtual sales force of the company. So each and every employee of the company can be a virtual sales force. And this is exactly what happens on the social media. If they carry the message, if they disseminate, they are given curated content, as Shivani spoke about, then they go out and interact. And the person who interacts with them with the first point of contact. So they help in building up sales. So that is one positive the social media brings around.
Yeah. Thank you, Prasenjit. Actually, Shivani explained very lovely, clarification. Because, you know, I was thinking this is a half glass of water. And it depends on your use, actually. It's just like science, whether it's a boon or curse. In childhood days, we wrote a lot of essays on that. So actually, you know, now I will come to Arpan. Arpan, you just, I want to know from you that in this contextual reference, now what should be our roadmap then? I mean, what do you think on social media? Because I am not going into the political arena. There is a positive, negative in political side also. Tulip revolution, it's a product of social media. Sahabag in Bangladesh, product of social media. I mean, not product, but it's a very important determining factor in that movement. But now, the lot of politicians, they're using the social media also because perception has become more important than the truth. And you can create a manufactured perception through social media. So this is a negative aspect also. So I don't know how to use this social media for our business future and not for the negative purpose of politicians or social intellectuals, etc., etc.
Okay. So, see, the interesting part is with everybody of the panelists having spoken so much, I think a lot of the points I had thought of talking about has got covered.
We expect synthesis from you. A lot of thesis and antithesis already we have achieved.
So, see, the interesting part about this subject, if you look at it, impact of social media on digital times, who are the ones who are impacted? It's you, me, everybody sitting in out here. So I think from a pure opinion perspective, everybody would have an experience and an opinion of their own. Now, as you rightly said, and we did here, and you again referred to the post-truth thing, and I could see Krishnan smiling. So, see, there is obviously this ability of human beings to perceive, filter what they want to use and how they want to use. And that is something, it is not, and I wouldn't say that is something limited to social media per se. That's something we do in every act of our life. So, in WhatsApps that we receive daily, I would say 8 out of 10 are false news. Now, how many of us would take the effort of seeing something, okay, Mahatma Gandhi said this, do I go and verify whether he actually said, or I believe, Mahatma Gandhi said this. So, the fact of the matter is, it's definitely very subject to perception, but at the same time, see, the pros are very far-reaching. At the end of it, how many, from a business perspective, consumers are you being able to reach in a very inexpensive manner, right? From a social perspective, why are we using, like, social media is what we make it, right? If it has become so big, so strong, because each of us have been participating in it. And my viewpoint is there are 3-4 things. I mean, why does anybody go to a Facebook, LinkedIn, Twitter? There are some things which people are using, which are like Instagram, Snapchat, which I am not so acquainted, but the new millennials are. But the purpose is pretty, I would categorize that either it's about information sharing or it's about supporting some cause, kind of a social cause, or in the example you gave, a political cause. The third piece being, I think it's also a lot about creating a social image. Possibly you'll find the happiest couples and the best and people having parties every day on social media. That's a distant truth from who or what they are actually. But that's a perception for your intelligence to assimilate, filter, and take it into your way of life that do I want to go to Goa every weekend just because A, B, and C is going? Or do I actually take facts into matter and take the best out of life? So from that perspective, I believe, at heart, from a pure business perspective, I've always been a sales marketing guy. So I think from a marketing standpoint, it has definitely given me a platform to reach out to people. It has impacted the sustainability of customer loyalty because of the kind of options that you get. And I think a very important part is this social word of mouth piece. Like if a restaurant advertises that my Thai food is great, and if a friend of mine who I know and has recommended it on a Zomato or something, my tendency to believe that is far more, and that is where the sales is coming for that restaurant. So the power of the social word of mouth is a very positive impact in terms of the impact of social media. And before I close, I think I'll give a perspective I had about a negative from a corporate standpoint. So we do a lot of work on the analytics side, cybersecurity side. So there are definitely very ugly examples of social media where you've come across instances where due to the lack of or the lack of ability of monitoring of children, their vulnerabilities are exposed. There is a very significant impact on brand equity because of a mole made up a mountain in a social media post. But all said and done, I think it is here to stay. Like we keep saying that in the digital age, you have to retrain, reskill yourself to be relevant today. Unless you can empower yourself to use social media positively, you may not be relevant going forward. And everything has a risk. You have to deal with the risk and you have to use the positives to make the best out of it. So like we used to say in the old days, whether you love it or hate it, you can't do without it. So that's the perspective I had.
Yeah, I'll just like to add one point. Social media is the only way a consumer can reach a company. You have your advertisements, you have your television slots, you have everything. But social media is a place where a consumer can actually write what he wants to interact with the company. And I'll give you a live example. We bought an AC from Amazon. We ordered it on Amazon. And while it came on time, the service engineer of the brand is Daikin, did not come for 3-4 days. And I think in the anger, my husband actually sent a tweet and hashtag fail on their site. And you know, within an hour, we had a call. Within a day, the AC was installed. Now that's the power of social media. There are negativities, yes, Facebook posts, you have your good morning posts on WhatsApp, you have your Goa trips, etc. on Facebook, but there is a positivity where a consumer can interact directly with a company and an action can be taken immediately. So that's what I wanted to say.
Thank you.
I want to say something because, you know, now that you've diddled with our cerebral cortex, you know, I keep noticing that in this post-truth
context.
And
I don't want to be a structured dialogue also. You can intervene and
that's fine, that's fine. So I noticed distinctly that you have some concern about social media causing riots. So I did want to put something, at least I believe, in context.
I don't want to make a word simplified, jump, but it's true that it happens.
Sure. So I want to make a comment on that. If Facebook is sort of a surrogate for social media, it was born in 2005, mainstreamed in 2007. So in India, it really became major, let's say 2008 onwards, or when Lehman Brothers went down, Facebook was going major here. I really can't remember, all the riots I remember were all before that.
No, but actually the role of catalyst as, social media, role of catalyst, now it is there.
Sure.
I mean, without that catalyst, riot happened.
That's the post-truth.
Thank you very much. I think that I have ignited his cerebral cortex. This is my success. But now I have, I think, 15 minutes we have. And I'm inviting 2-3 questions to this panelists and speakers. You can ask them. I cannot take many questions, but I am 15 minutes, so.
I'm Joydeep Bhattacharya, also from TCG. Now, I had a question. You see, how is privacy getting impacted by social media? Is it a good thing or a bad thing? Particularly with respect to two points. Number one, recently Supreme Court has given a verdict that privacy is a part of our fundamental right, but I'm a little confused in this aspect because I understand out of the 122 official languages, not official languages, acknowledged languages and 1500 odd or 1600 odd dialects in our country, there is no single word in any of these languages which is equivalent of the word privacy, the way privacy is conveyed. So how important is this impact? And it is a genuine question I'm asking this elite panel.
To whom actually you are asking the question?
I mean, to you as a journalist and to Mr.
Journalists,
Chatterjee.
Journalists, actually, we ask questions.
And to Mr. Chatterjee or anyone in the panel who's ready to answer that.
I mean, who is keen to give the reply. Because, you know, now the global campaign is that end of privacy. After the end of history, now the new slogan is end of privacy.
Actually, I couldn't understand your question.
Okay. The question is, how is social media encroaching upon our privacy? And is it a good thing or a bad thing, particularly in the Indian context, specifically because, number one, on one hand, we have the Supreme Court giving a judgment saying that privacy is a part of our fundamental right. And on the other hand, none of the Indian languages, be it an official language, be it a recognized language or a dialect, I understand from my linguist friends, has an equivalent of the word privacy because entire Indian cultures have grown without
give the reply.
I think you've
you
replied your own
questions.
Yeah,
now
you've replied your own question. I got the reply. My sense is, if you look at a problem statement, the 50% of our country doesn't make a sustainable livelihood. And if you think about the context of privacy, and this is a larger digital issue, what is happening is by virtue of customizing to you or understanding your preferences or your needs at that time, there is a frictionlessness that is being created in a transaction. I took the example of Uber, right? Uber has created a frictionless transportation experience for you and me, and therefore we've stopped driving, and there are 400,000 people who now have jobs as a consequence. So I think this is a larger issue, and as you rightly said, the fact that no Indian language has a word, I don't know. This may be a post-truth comment you are making, but I'm sure Jayanto can verify it for us. But if it does not have, potentially, to my mind, digital has to be used to really solve a lot of other societal issues for us, and this is my personal view. There are much larger problems facing us. We can come to the... I don't have a specific perspective on just the privacy.
Yeah, I think that's a valid point. Now, if you take social media like Facebook, by its very essence, it's meant to be people don't share, you know, they only share what they want the world to see. So there's no question of any infringement of privacy because nobody else will post something on you which you cannot control. It's you who's sharing only parts of your life which you want your friends or your, you know, colleagues to see about you. And as far as it, you know, as far as these other, you know, platforms such as, you know, Uber, etc., they only take information. They have algorithms which, or Amazon, for instance, they only take, you know, they have algorithms which only, make out what are your likes and dislikes. And there is a thing called targeted advertising. They target their advertising to suit your needs, which again is not an infringement on your privacy, per se. So I, unless, I mean, there is a, and of course there are cyber laws which are coming into place, which again will, you know, address that issue further.
Thank you. The next question, yeah.
Hi, good evening. I'm Vinod Singh from ITC Infotech. My question is to all the members on the panel. If you follow Twitter, there are 40% followers these days are bots, if you follow major politicians. And the agenda that is being set on the trending topics is, how do I differentiate whether it's being set by bots or the real human behind it? Because the agendas are being set on Twitter. My second question is that Facebook is recently launching a Facebook platform for children below 14. So is it not that they are going extra mile and they are intruding personal life of people? So this is these are the two questions that I want response on.
You want to
I will answer the second one. Okay. In fact, that's a concern I had. In fact, I was planning to put that across. See, one of the concerns that I feel personally is when I look at my kids. Okay, they are so tuned to social media. Okay, like in our times when we had our free hours, etc., we used to go down and play. Okay, more of outdoor activity. Today's kids are hooked onto social media, and that is a serious concern. Okay, they. Even the teenagers, when they come and they meet together, they, instead of talking and chatting around, are, you know, tweeting each other, okay? And if you're talking about the millennials and all those stuff, they go about making, adding friends rather than making friends, okay? So that's how life is. And I'm really concerned about that, because at our age and mature individuals, we know how to handle this. We know the pros and cons, and we know how to bypass the traps. But I'm really concerned about that. So your Facebook thing, I think will add more to the misery, because it already is there. You know, I don't think we need a platform to create to that. It's already in a mess, and it's even going further down. Okay. About the bots, I don't know. It's very, very difficult to do that. But what we do is actually many of the tweets that are done, even if it's not the bots, it's all ghost written. Okay, you know what ghost written is. The person doesn't write it. Someone else writes on behalf. So it's equivalent to a bot. Okay. So it may not be coming from the same person, but obviously someone from the behalf of his writes this whole thing. I don't know, difficult to find out whether, you know, we can find for tweet bots or concern. Yeah. But that is a concern, I agree with you.
Yeah, I can take only one question now, yep, because time is short. And
so I think the person with the mic has the privilege, but okay. Sir, if they allow, thank you so much.
If the question is specific.
Very specific, sir.
And to whom you are asking.
Yeah, I would ask Ms. Kapoor this particular question. Yeah. So I come from a cybersecurity background. My name is Neeraj Agarwal. I want to understand that social media can be a platform to share all the good things about a company and all the positivity. But do you think it can also act as a good agent when the company gets struck by a negative thing? Say there is a cybersecurity incident or some bad press going on. How can a company turn it around on the digital platform by taking a proactive response and leverage it? So what would be the few things which a company can do to make social media a positive thing in case of a negative experience?
I think my question was around the same line. Only thing is, you know, should Webull advertise like that on Facebook? Or should it advertise all the same contributions it had to Bengal throughout the life of Webull? Should, you know, NASCOM advertise on Facebook like that? Should you advertise processes, procedures of your organization to counter any sort of mishaps that are happening in this world, people who are writing against you? Should you do advertisements in that way, or should you do the conventional advertisement?
A very good question, I would say. There's a two way of looking at it. This digital media, you talked about whether we should use Facebook or whether you should use processes. I'll answer his question first. The mediums that you want to use is completely who you're targeting and what you want to say. You should use a blend of both. You need to be on the digital, you need to be on the, you know, ATL as we call it, ads, or how you want to communicate through mailers, etc. So you need to do a blend of both.
But social digital media users are only wanting to target you when you are making a mistake. Okay, when you are making a mistake, or if not a mistake, they want to target you.
So what is the defense mechanism you have for such a situation? You have to have on social media. If you do not have on social media, then you will always be in the pit.
So to your question, we have, as companies, we have social media tools, listening tools. We listen to what consumers say, and we respond to them immediately. The speed
see,
and
any,
agility.
Any organization is based on ethics. Yes. They're looking for ethics of that organization. So you advertise your ethics on social media. If you do not advertise your ethics in all processes and procedures, you will always be counterattacked.
It's a continuous process, actually.
So you need to, so exactly, social media is all about what you talk to the consumers. There would be some negativity. You have your cybersecurity now act very, very strong. In fact, if there is something negative, and companies as well as individuals can actually, in fact, there was an individual in ITC Infotech Bangalore who, there was somebody following him and writing things about him. He complained to the cybersecurity and immediately the action was taken. So your cybersecurity laws are very strong today. But having said that, companies have to keep listening and seeing what's happening. And now the good part is there are data-driven AI tools who are actually mapping the social media to find out where there is a negativity.
Yeah, there's data-driven.
I'm sorry. Actually, the time, the main problem created by Einstein, time is very relative. Actually, for you, it's a very good time to talk, but for the organizers. So actually, you can talk to her
we'll
later.
Talk,
just after
we'll
this
talk after
session,
this
sideline talk is always welcome. Actually, the problem is, actually, I don't think that I can take any other question.
Okay, so we are into the IT infrastructure business and cybersecurity. So the question was about attacks, right? Cyber attacks and DDoS and ransomware. So it actually happened with us for several months back. So first of all, it came out in the western parts immediately because of social media. We came to know it, and all our clients, etc., we took severe protection about it. So obviously, when the ransomware attack hit us, we were well prepared and equipped with it. So one of the positives of social media, it helps you to gain advantage by what's happening on the other parts of the world and equip yourselves, safeguarding your interest.
I think you are satisfied with the answer. Thank you very much for your patience. And what I understood, that actually there is no tutu mame in this debate. And in our mental attitude always actually compels us to go Mohun Bagan versus East Bengal, Hilsa or Pran. So actually this social media is also, the truth lies in that gray area. It is good, it is bad. It is actually up to us how we will use it, how we will combat it, the negative issues also. And I think the future lies in digital media, that nobody, it's a never denying fact. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. We thank our chairperson, Mr. Jayanta Ghoshal, and I will request you to kindly present mementos to our speakers. We'd like to request Mr. Jayanta Ghoshal to give away the mementos. We thank Mr. Krishnan Chatterjee, thank you very much. We thank you, ma'am, Vinita Bajoria. Thank you very much for this interesting session, ma'am. We thank you, ma'am, Shivani Kapoor. We thank you, Mr. Prasenjit Roy. And we thank you, Mr. Arpan Majumdar. I'm sure the discussion will continue offline, and we thank Mr. Jayanta Ghoshal for moderating and sharing this very interesting session.